Just that praise that bubbles up and just recognizes Christ for who he is. And my husband was praying this morning, and he was in the prayer. He said, "Lord, thank you for this day where they where they actually recognized fully for the very first time. And he said, who you, and in my head I was going to say were, and he said are, and it just brought me up short. And I thought, for who you are. Would you stand this morning? We're going to ask God's presence to be real in our sanctuary this morning. If you have one of these things, wave it big as we sing Hosanna. Father, we are so very, very thankful for your presence that preceded us into the sanctuary this morning. And Lord, we thank you for the celebration of today. As we look forward to next Sunday, which is also going to be joyous, Lord, we know that between now and next Sunday, there are some times that we need to really reflect on what actually happened between the two.
Amen.
But Father, for today, we want to recognize Jesus Christ fully as Messiah and Savior. So would you hear our praise this morning and be blessed by it? In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Just because it is kind of the day of praise, amen?
Yeah.
That's what it was all about, and so I thought that we'd kind of keep that theme going this morning. We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house
of the Lord.
Amen. Thank you, Jan. I hope you came in with your hearts full of praise this morning. If you didn't, I hope by now it's getting there, and I hope that it continues to just blossom, and by the time we get to the fourth one of our choruses, you're just belting it out with true praise from your heart. Let's sing this together this morning.
We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. And we offer unto you the sacrifice. Offer up to you the sacrifices of joy. We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. And we offer up to you the sacrifice. Thanksgiving, and we
people in that crowd that day waving palm fronds. And I bet you there was two little boys with a mom. This sword fight with a palm frond. Isn't that awesome? And mom's going, no, don't, no. That's awesome. Isn't that wonderful?
Amen.
I love that. Yes, be those boys.
In case you don't know, your pastor is passionate about little boys just being little boys. I think he mentions it every single Sunday in some fashion or another. But it is awesome. Girls, pastor loves you. I just want to tell you that pastor loves you. Right, pastor?
Amen. Boys are easy to raise than girls.
Thank goodness we are here, because we need to exalt our Lord and Savior this morning. This course isn't as fast as the last two, but it is a wonderful, simple. He is exalted. The King is exalted on high. We're lifting him up this morning, and we're lifting our praises to him. Sing this with us, will you? Instruments at the ends of your arms, and I'm sure that God would love to hear that this morning. So let there be praise in our house with our mouths and our hands.
Let there be praise, let there be joy in our hearts. Sing to the Lord, give the glory.
Sure that you listen to these and write them in your bulletin. The first one that's not in there is that we are having a work day that's coming up. Originally, that work day was scheduled for April 23rd, but it has had to be moved to April 30th. And so put that on your calendar, April 30th. I think, is it 8:30 in the morning, Bruce? 8:30 in the morning. And then Bruce is going to have more details about that day on our Facebook page. And so if you want to keep checking that out, Bruce will kind of let you know what's going on between now and then. But for right now, reserve April 30th on your calendar. For the morning at least, and probably lunch will be included. So plan to stay through that time as well. The other announcement that's not in the bulletin is that we are having a Good Friday service this Friday evening at 6:30. I believe we'll be having communion together. It's not ever a long service, but it is an impacting service, and it is a great way to start that 3 days as we recognize. I know the day before that is Maundy Thursday. We don't usually do anything formally with that, but when we get to Good Friday and it represents such a part of that story, it's the beginning of the end, and then the beginning of the end and the beginning. So as you prepare your hearts for Easter morning, I think we need to feel that solitude of Good Friday. So plan to join us at 6:30 this Friday evening. There is the board will be meeting this Tuesday night at 6:30. It'll be our first full board meeting since we've elected and put into place the new board. And so board members, please plan on being there. I think we'll be meeting at Casey Hall. Shoebox Ministry continues. T-shirts are still needed for Sue. And we are starting Sunday school in May. Not sure exactly what that's going to look like, but it's going to be a fun day. You're not going to want to miss it. Be here in about 10 minutes to 9. Amen. On the very first Sunday of May. I'm going to ask if our ushers would come forward as we prepare our hearts to continue in worship with the giving of our tithes and offerings. What a privilege it is to give to the work of the kingdom. I hope that you find that to be a privilege, and that to know that you're helping to grow the kingdom of God. Let's pray over our offering this morning. Father, we are grateful for the opportunity and the privilege to give to your kingdom work. We ask that whatever is given in the plate this morning, you will see the heart of the giver, and that you will bless it accordingly. We pray that you would spread that blessing to a world that needs you so desperately. We ask, Lord, that you would see this as a gift, that you would see it as love from our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen.
The city, they run on the wall. Raise the army, the
God's army. That song will inspire you. I love that. That's a great song. Sovereign Lord, as we get close to Easter, this song just kind of recognizes all those pieces and parts of what it took from Jesus to make it possible for us to have eternal life with him in glory. And I don't think there's been an Easter that we have been here where so many people so close to Easter have lost loved ones. And Easter is that hope that you're going to see them again. And there really couldn't be a more strategically placed holiday in your lives for you that have lost those loved ones. And you can hold on to that hope that you're going to spend eternity with them. I love that. He is our sovereign Lord. He is the only Lord.
Amen.
The world can tell you there are many lords, but that's just not true. There is one. He is sovereign. He is over all. He is in all. He is through all. And I want you to just, as you sing this song, righteous life, flesh so torn, wounded hand, brow with thorn. It just tells that Easter story. I pray that you will just rejoice in the ending, because that's where the joy comes. So just enjoy fellowshipping with our family. Become part of us. We love you. Alleluia, alleluia. Simple, simple chorus. Very few words to this chorus, and yet says so much. As we just lift our hearts in praise to Him, as we prepare our hearts to receive whatever it is that He has for us. I love the title of our sermon this morning. It's Be the Donkey. And I want you to embrace being the donkey this morning. And that may sound funny, but you know there's a lot of truth in what we're going to hear in sermon this morning. So as you give Him your praise, as your praise goes up to Him, would you receive what He sends down to your heart this morning and just be thankful for who you are in Him.
Lord God Almighty, maker of the heaven and the earth, Father, we seek You now, as we've been seeking You throughout this morning. Father, it says in Your word that we run to it. Mm. We seek Your face, and we get excited about it, Lord. I saw the excitement as we waved our palm fronds, Lord, and I can only imagine what it was like that day. With reckless abandon, they worship You for who You are. They exalted it and found joy in You, our King. And Lord, on this side of things, we want to do that today. We want to exalt You and lift You high and praise Your holy name for who You are. Lord, for the action in the present tense of who You are in our lives. We seek Your face, Lord. It says through Your word so many times that may my enemy not exalt over me. Because You are in control, Lord.
Amen.
We trust You. We seek You. We release it all to You. Lord, You are amazing. And so many times when I try and think of glory and what it means and what it beholds, and I'm stumped because of how good you are, and just my thoughts go crazy about what it's going to be like and how I get to worship you with full heart and full mind. Fully, I get to fully worship you. To think about how that will feel. And not just me, as I look to the left and I look to the right, in front of me, behind me, myriad of people worshiping you in one accord. Though I don't want to fast forward life, I look forward to that moment. Wow. All because you chose to come to earth in the most vulnerable state as a baby, grew to be a man, perfect, without guile, and willingly endured the worst punishments. And not only did you endure that punishment, you rose from the grave. That's our victory. That's what we look forward to. That's our strength. That's our hope. That's our everything. That our Savior, the one and only true God, rose from the grave. All these so-called other gods, they never put themselves behind everybody and sacrifice for the people. You did, because you are true. Amen. You are the way, the truth, the life. So Lord, as we celebrate this joyous occasion today, may we take this joy and live it every day. We have been given the most precious gift of salvation. Help us to use it for your glory. Not hide it in a box, but show our priceless treasure to everyone.
Amen.
What a gift. What a Savior. What a God. So Father, as we go forward in our service and we hear your broken bread, Lord, may we attentively receive it. Lord, I pray now for our pastor who comes up here. Lord, I pray a special prayer for his strength. Lord, as he does so much behind the scenes that a lot of us don't have any idea what goes into it. The love, the regard, the care, the burdens that he carries for all of us. Lord, we are blessed to see this man of God walk after you. And Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ.
Right.
Thank you that we get to see the doubt in front of our faces. Because no doubt, Lord, at one point we can say and see the examples of, for those who walk behind us, may they find us faithful.
Yes, amen.
So Lord, we lift him up to you. We thank you for him and his wife who so diligently work for this church. But they work for your glory, Lord. They give it all to you. So thank you for that. I thank you for my brothers and sisters. I thank you for the visitors. They're brothers and sisters too. That's the beauty of it all. They're going to be to the left, to the right, to the forward, behind. All for your glory, Lord.
Yes.
I wish my inadequate words could truly describe how I feel. How blessed I am. Thank you for knowing my heart. Even when I look in the mirror and I see failure, you look at me and see your son.
Thank you, Lord.
We give you this day, Father. Thank you that personally, here in Windham, our doors are open and we can smell the fresh air and breathe the love that you gave to us.
Amen.
You are matchless. You are mighty. You are worthy. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Amen.
The little children shall lead them.
Miss Kathy, you have the little doctors this morning?
Yeah.
Go, Goldie. We'll be looking in Mark 11 in a moment. But I invite you to stand and turn to John 3, verse 30. John 3, verse 30, this is going to be a scripture that we start with. We'll read that together. This is John 3, verse 30. He must increase, and I must decrease. Father, we thank you for this word of God this morning, and that's our prayer. That we would decrease so that you could be seen. And we get us out of the way. Boy, self is such a hungry beast. It wants to be in the front all the time. So, Father, help us decrease today so that you may increase. We love you, Lord. We give you this awesome Palm Sunday. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you. You may be seated. He must increase and I must decrease. These are words that were spoken by one of the New Testament's greatest evangelists. He had acquired a following of disciples to listen to his message that had not been seen in the Hebrew nation in years, this kind of following. He had young men chasing him down, begging to become a part of his inner circle. Now you've got to think of this today. This is very heady stuff going on at this time. He had young men chasing him down, begging to be part of his inner circle. He had the established church leaders either aching to drop their guards and follow him, or have his head on a plate. John the Baptist had unbelievable spiritual and physical gravitas. Now, gravitas means influence, great spiritual momentum and influence. And he could have kept all of this to himself and maintained that following of young men and admirers. And in today's world, that seems to be all the rage, doesn't it? We have these things called influencers. They do these dumb things in the middle of the road trying to get kids to emulate them. Yet this day, John stops. And once again, he points them back to the reason that he's an evangelist at all, Jesus Christ. John allowed himself in the eyes of his followers to decrease and the awareness of Jesus Christ by those same men through John's life to increase. He left so that Jesus could be seen. This morning on Palm Sunday 2022, I'm not going to preach about what's happening in the world around us. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Instead, I'm going to remind us all that Christ has not changed one little bit.
Amen.
He is the same yesterday, today, and what?
Forever.
Forever. Very good. This is Palm Sunday, so we live it out as Palm Sunday, and it's a Hosanna kind of Sunday. Amen?
Amen.
It is Hosanna. I love the way you guys are using your fronds. You all got your personality showing. Some were hiding behind it, going like this, singing Hosanna. Some were waving it. Some were kind of doing this. And the boys were sword fighting. I love the way you guys were praising the Lord. We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
You know what that means? It means you come and you give freely to God. Because as you do, He takes it, He receives it, He covers it with His Spirit, and He gives it right back to us, and we grow deeper in fellowship. That's why we bring that sacrifice. Today is Palm Sunday, and it's leading and preparing our hearts and minds for the greatest Sunday of the year. I love this. It's Resurrection Sunday. It's Independence Day for those who are redeemed in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
If you've been redeemed, that's your Independence Day.
That's right. Amen.
I love the 4th of July. I did a career in the military, and my wife's dad was born on Flag Day, so he was a big patriot. And I love the 4th of July, but Independence Day is Easter Sunday for me.
That's right.
This morning, I would like us to become like John the Baptist. So we're going to decrease while Christ would increase. You got a bulletin today. Look at your bulletin. You see you got a donkey on the front of that bulletin. Write your name above that donkey. Write your name above the donkey. Then look at your neighbor and go, hee-haw! Look at your neighbor. It's your chance, MJ. Call Jeff an old mule. No, don't do that. Look at your neighbor and go, hee-haw! You are donkeys. Larry, you can do that to Nancy. Nancy, go back to Larry. Hee-haw! We need to become donkeys for Jesus today. Put your name above that donkey. That's you today. As we walk towards Easter morning, I'd ask that we become spiritual donkeys for the Lord and surrender all we are to Him. I would ask that we submit to the Holy Spirit and do whatever it is He leads us to do today. Don't be ducking and covering today. If the Holy Spirit stir in your heart, don't duck and cover. That's so easy to do. Would you stand there in the grace of God and receive what He would have for us today? I want to look at a couple of things about this donkey that Christ rode into Jerusalem that day, the day of triumphant entry. Now remember, we are those donkeys today. This is us I'm talking about. First, the donkey was needed by Jesus. You donkeys. Second, as we come unto Jesus, we allow ourselves to be under His control. Third, we will carry Jesus into the multitudes. Who do you know today, right now, that needs Jesus as Savior? Will you be that donkey and carry the Savior into their lives? And lastly, as we carry Jesus to the people, we need to disappear so that He is seen. This is Mark 11. Now as they drew near to Jerusalem, to Bethpage and Bethany, at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of His disciples and said to them, "Go to the village opposite you, and as soon as you have entered it, you will find a colt of a donkey tied there, which no one has ever sat on. Muy importante, that phrase, very important, on which no one has ever sat. Loose it and bring it to me. And if anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' tell them that the Lord hath need of it, and then immediately bring it here." So they went their way and found the colt tied by the door outside in the street, where He said, and they loosed it. But some of those who stood by said to them, "What are you doing, loosening the colt?" And they spoke to them as Jesus commanded, saying, "The Lord hath need of him." So they let him go. Jesus told them to go, and they went. Amen. What a concept. Jesus tells us to do something as His donkeys, and we go. Number one step in being a donkey for Jesus is to obey what He tells you to do. Whatever the Holy Spirit stirs you to do, I don't care if it's in the middle of a work day and you're surrounded by your co-workers, whatever the Holy Spirit tells you to do, would you please be the donkey and just go do it? See, if we're ever going to reach that spot where we simply obey whatever the Holy Spirit leads us to do, it must start with the faith to take that first step in the direction that He asks us to go in. That's where it begins. Now, these two disciples of Jesus who have been following Him and seeing the miraculous things they've been doing for 3 years went as He directed them. They believed what He said because they had watched Him over those past 3+ years, and He was always faithful to meet their needs. How about us? Can we go today? Can we remember the faithfulness of our Lord Jesus over these past 3 years?
Amen.
We are all here. We're all healthy. We're all praising God. On Palm Sunday 2022, we're all here because of the faithfulness of our Savior Jesus Christ. No matter what the world may be saying or doing around us, will we go? He said, "Tell them the Lord hath need of them." And that's an awesome feeling, isn't it? To be needed by the Lord. I love that. To think that the God of all, the Savior of all, He has need of us. Now, we know that God can do whatever He wants without us, but He calls to us, and He tells us that He does indeed have a need for us. And I have to ask you, have you heard that call today? Has the Holy Spirit of the Lord been speaking to you about something? I don't know what it is. It might be the call of God to become a pastor. It might be that He wants you to pray more. It might be that He wants you to get up and get to church if you're home watching this on Facebook. I don't know what's going on, but have you heard that call today? The Holy Spirit speaking to you, letting you know that God has a need for you within His kingdom work. And again, the question is to us right now, before we get to Easter Sunday, will we be the donkey? Now, during this time, donkeys were a hot commodity. They were the pickup trucks of their day. And to have one was to be seen kind of as a person of influence. And isn't it grand when you have a friend with a pickup truck? Especially on moving day.
Amen.
Boy, I had a pickup truck in Texas. Actually, I've had a pickup truck everywhere but these last few years. Our whole marriage. And everybody wanted to borrow my pickup truck. I had a 65 Chevy long bed, straight six with a great big cylinders. And man, it was a nice truck. Got it for $400. Amazing, $400. Everybody wanted to borrow my truck. Isn't it grand when we have a pickup truck? Now, Corvette's awesome, Bruce. Yeah. But you can only put two boxes in the front seat beside you. But if you get a pickup truck, donkeys were the pickup truck of this day. They mentioned all through the Word of God. They're used in dozens of ways to illustrate what God wants to have done, getting done. Now here in this story of Jesus getting ready to go down the hill, it's a special type of donkey. It was an unbroken colt, and that's important for us to hear today. It was an unbroken colt. Now this is a young donkey that has never been ridden, and it was there in that capacity to fulfill the prophecy of Zechariah 9, verse 9. It says, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you, and he is just, and he has salvation in his hand, riding a lowly donkey colt, the foal of a donkey." That's so important because for a king to be riding a donkey into the lives of these people, it spoke of a peaceable king. Now I want you to picture yourself again today as the donkeys. This donkey will carry Jesus into the lives of people who need him. And it was declaring a peaceable king. He wasn't coming on a flaming, beautiful white stallion, which was to bespeak that he was going to take over your life and turn them upside down. As I wrote this out, I thought about how we must be these spiritual donkeys and bring Jesus to others in this capacity. As he came in, the king on the donkey, they would see a peaceable king. Do you think the world has had enough of the warring and the arguing and the factitious breaks and pieces of society? Do you think they've had enough of that warring going on? The white stallion kind of guy or gal? Isn't it time that somebody brought Jesus to them and let them see that peaceable, loving king? You're the donkey today. See, in order for the donkey to be used in the service for God back here, in this specific prophecy, it must never have carried any burden of any kind. In order for the donkey to be used in this capacity, it had to be free from the world's demands. You donkeys, we donkeys. Did you hear that? Mm-hmm. In order for this donkey to be used by God to carry Jesus into the lives of those who needed him, it had to be free of the world's demands.
That's right.
Get it? And it had to be unbroken, as per prophecy, unbroken. We'll get to that in a moment. Jesus said, "Tell them that the Lord hath need of it." Well, Pastor, does the Lord have need of me in today's world? If you are a follower of Jesus Christ, he hath need of you.
That's right.
And he said it flat out in Matthew 5. He said, "You are the light of the world. You are the city on the hill, which cannot be hidden. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven." Let them see Jesus. Yes, I'd say he hath need of you. He left us in this world to do that which needs to be done regarding the fulfillment of the Great Commission in Matthew 28. So on this Palm Sunday, 1 week before Easter, 1 week before Resurrection, Independence Day, I can say between now and then, Jesus has need of us.
Amen.
Amen.
The question is, and it always comes to this, will we allow him to use us? So Jesus has this little unbroken donkey colt brought to him. Now here's the beginning of that donkey surrendering what he thinks needs to happen and doing what the Lord knows needs to have happen. Remember that little donkey is unbroken. They brought the colt to Jesus, threw their cloaks on it, and then Jesus sat upon the colt. Have you ever watched somebody break a horse? It's unbelievable. It's crazy. I had a Sunday school teacher try to break his horse. He had a colt and he raised her up. She was about a yearling. And they built this little homemade stall out of all the trees around his farm. And this old guy that knew horses supposedly was holding the horse. And Robbie got up on the back of that horse, and she wasn't having any of it. She threw him 50 feet in the air, and he fell right down in that stall and busted everything. They build that stall and they lead the horse in, they put a bit on it, a bridle, and then somebody really brave gets to sit on the back of that unbroken animal. And that's important because the natural proclivity of the unbroken animal is rebellion. The natural proclivity of this unbroken colt was rebellion to anything and anyone that's trying to control it. I want you to think of us today. The natural tendency, the natural proclivity of anything that tries to guide us is to rebel against it. It's the natural self. It's the uncontrollable urge to buck anything off of our bodies that we don't want there, that would send us to any place that we don't want to go. Think self. Now this donkey's colt was no different. It says donkey's colt, and sometimes we can picture the little tiny donkeys that we see in Sunday school stories, but this is a full-size colt. It has the physical stature of a mature donkey. It had all the natural rebellion built within it from birth. Did you get that? Donkeys. What Jesus had need of, what he's going to use to carry the new covenant into the lives of mankind, had a natural predisposition to rebel against what Jesus wanted, these donkeys. But Jesus still had need of it. In spite of our natural tendencies to self, our natural tendencies to resist what God would call us to do, he still wants to use us.
Amen.
Isn't that awesome? Isn't that awesome? Pastor Murray prayed today. He said, in spite of our mess-ups, you still want to use us. In spite of our natural bent, in spite of us being born into sin, Jesus still has need for us. He still looks for us to become these spiritual donkeys, to bring the light of God into the lives of the lost.
Amen.
But the Lord hath need of it. So they brought the colt to Jesus, placed their cloaks upon it, and Jesus sat on the colt. Now, I have no study material to back this up, but I know from working with animals that they have spirit. Animals have spirit. They don't have a soul, but they have spirit. That's why we can eat a cow. Sorry, Amy. We can eat a cow. A cow has spirit. She doesn't have any soul. We couldn't eat it. But animals have spirit. They can feel when a person loves them. They can feel when a person doesn't. We have a little mixed dog. Some of you know her. Her name's Lucy. She's 6.5 pounds of raging terror. She's not good. And she knows when my wife and I come in the house what kind of mood we're in. She can sense it. And we have devotions every morning, just about every morning. And we're just sitting there reading the devotional together. And I guess she must hear me say, let's pray or whatever. But as soon as we shuffle, just move a little bit, she hears it. She gets out of her bed and she comes running over and she puts her paws up on my knee and puts her head down. Isn't that cute? Not saying she's anything special. She's just a dog. But she can feel the way that we love her. I say all this because there's no doubt in my mind that as Jesus, listen to me. If we'll allow it, as Jesus sets his hand upon we donkeys, we can feel it. If we'll allow it, we can feel his love. You know, I bet that this little donkey did that. Nothing to back it up. But as he does that, as he lays his hand on that little donkey's head and he feels that love, think about what must have been going through the mind of Jesus. This is a pinnacle moment. So he's about to go down the hillside into a time of true celebration where for the very first time, the people are going to honestly celebrate who he is. He's the Son of God. He's the Savior of all mankind. He's about to go outside the city and weep for their blindness, the spiritual leaders, for their spiritual blindness, their spiritual stubbornness for not receiving who he is. He said, on this, the day, your day, you're missing it. He's going to face abandonment by his men and denial. He's going to have the very same people who are cheering him in the moment calling for his death on the cross. He's going to suffer the brutality of the crucifixion. All the cruelty and pain of Calvary. And then, this is the good part, he's going to find the joy of a risen Savior.
Amen.
All for obeying the will of Dad. He's about to start the new covenant, wherein whosoever will may find their way home to God. You know, I bet these things must have been going through his thoughts as he goes to sit on this colt. As Jesus touched the colt, do you think the colt's natural proclivity to try to buck the cloak off of him? Do you think maybe that rose up? I don't know. All I can speak to is the natural reaction within these kind of circumstances as Jesus would lay his hand upon me sometimes. Sometimes as I feel the hand of the Master upon me through the Holy Spirit, you know what my tendency is to do is, no, that can't be right. I can't go down that hill right now, God. I have so many preconceived notions of what I think it should look like. I don't know what to call them. These natural tendencies, with them in place, the colt had to yield to the hand of the Savior. He had to allow the power of Jesus to cause him to not be that natural donkey. As odd as it might sound, the colt, the unbroken colt, had to empty himself of those natural tendencies to resist the hand of the Savior. Jesus wanted to use him to carry the message of salvation into the lives of millions. Hundreds of thousands of people, multitudes are there. It was a Passover week. He wanted to ride this colt into that crowd of cheering people and let them see the hope of their salvation. What an honor for the donkey. Say amen.
Amen.
What an honor for we donkeys that God would use us to ride into the multitudes of lost people and let them see his son. To be used by God in spite of our natural tendencies. To bring the good news of Jesus to people. That's us. We don't have to do it. We get to do it.
Amen.
I wrote that out and I thought of Angela. We don't have to tell people about Jesus. We get to tell people about Jesus. But the colt had to die to the natural self. Had to let go of what it wanted to do, buck against the Lord. And had to allow the Spirit of God to fill him. What an awesome moment this is. You know that we have a Greek word for that. It's called kenosis. For you pastors. Now, kenosis, it means to be broken and spilled out. It means to allow the natural self to be emptied out. See, Jesus Christ had to perform this act himself. He doesn't ask us to do anything that he hasn't already done. The first time was when he left heaven to come to earth and be born as a little baby. First big act of kenosis, the breaking and emptying of self. The second time was when he had been stretched across that big stone in the garden. Remember that? Sweating those great drops of blood. He cried to be released from this moment. But if there's no other way, Father, not my will, but thy will be done. He had to empty himself again. He had to perform the act of kenosis, broken and spilled out, so God could fill him with his will and bring us a way home. The act of kenosis is critical for us. You know that, don't you? The breaking and spilling out of us. And it's critical in the lives of God's people if we're going to become true donkeys for Jesus. Then kenosis must happen. If we're going to be free from the trappings of the world and all their opinions, and my wife kind of said it today, this all roads lead to God thing. You know what? That's a true statement. All roads lead to God. One God, Jehovah. The question is, what are you going to say when you stand in front of him? Yes. Every life leads to God. Eventually. We have to have this act of being broken and spilled out. When we're saved, we're sealed with the promise of the Holy Spirit. And we get all that God is. At that moment, we are filled with the Holy Spirit. But as we grow closer to God, and this is the secret, as we go to church, as we disciple, as we read his word, as we pray, as we do all the things that we know we're supposed to do, become men and women of God, we grow closer to God. And all of a sudden, we realize we want all that we can have of God. And we've already got it, but what we're really saying is that we want to give God all of us. We reach that point where we're sick and tired of being sick and tired. That was me. I had a bad temper. Ooh, I was an angry guy. I never hit my wife and kids, but I fight and drop a hat. And I was a good fighter. And God delivered me from that. That was my kenosis moment. When he broke me in half and poured that old temper out and filled me with his power. I saw, it's like for 30 years, 35 years as Christian, I've been carrying around a 4x8 sheet of plywood with a little tiny hole in it saying, isn't God good? That thing weighed 80 pounds. And I was so tired, I said, isn't God good? Oh, isn't God good? I want to put this down, God. Isn't God good? God reached down my hands that day and went, yoink. He said, no, isn't God good? It was a powerful time to be broken of me. I spent 3.5 hours on my face on the kitchen floor. When I got up, I knew the power of kenosis. I knew the power of giving all of who I am, this donkey, to God. See, we reached a point in our walk where we want to be all in. We want this emptying of self. We want this kenosis moment. As it takes place, we allow the Holy Spirit to fill us. As we stand broken and spilled out, he fills us, and we become just like the donkey this day. We stand awaiting his purpose for our lives. I hope you felt this. In your Christian walk, I hope you reached that point. I pray that all of us have come to a moment in which Jesus Christ lays his hand upon us and we feel his love and his grace and his care flowing from our peaceable King, and we stand broken before him. And that powerful joy begins to fill us. And now we refuse to buck. We refuse to toss those cloaks. We refuse to toss and try to shake his hand off of our lives because we want what he wants. As I said, I don't know what this colt felt that day. I'm sure that what we do know from animal husbandry, it felt love and regard like all animals can. But the heart of the matter is, he did not act out of his own natural nature. He submitted to the will of the Son of God. Walking into Easter Sunday, this donkey submitted to the will of God to take Jesus to the people. Did you hear that? Write your name above that donkey. See, when this happens and we let go of self, we allow God to fill us completely with his Spirit. We get rid of all of us. We want all of God now. We got him when we were saved, but we kind of kept that one piece of us there. And finally, we've ripped the top off that jar and all of God rushes in. It's been there all the time. We go through this act of kenosis, and then there's something else that happens from the kenosis, and this is important. This is why we want to tell people about Jesus. From the kenosis moment, you know what happens? There's another cool Greek word that begins with K. We develop something called koinonia. It's fellowship. It's deep, honest, uninterrupted fellowship with the Father through the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And it is such a grand feeling. It's not a grand feeling when you get up and all of a sudden you just tie in through the Holy Spirit and you go, woo, man, I belong to God today. Even though I got to go to work, I got to face that guy that always tweaks my nose, or that girl that always tweaks my nose. Even though I got to get up and, oh, man, I'll tell you, when God broke me open and poured me out, I was working for these guys, and, man, it was so tough. Man, that was tough, tough, tough. But I got up the next day, and I couldn't wait to get there. It looked all brand new to me. My fellowship with God had enhanced. The koinonia had taken place. Everything looked brand new in the Lord. So this colt has the Son of God sitting on his back, walking down the hill into the perfect will of God. His little donkey. And people were shouting praises and hosannas to Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit was turned up to full, and the people couldn't stop themselves from seeing who Jesus really is. Do you understand that? If we will be this free in our in relationship with Jesus, people will not be able to stop seeing what we know is true, and that's Jesus in our lives. That's a great feeling, isn't it? When you walk into a certain place and the Holy Spirit has got you so filled up with power that all they see is that, they don't see you. And they give you one of those looks like, what is that? I love that. Do you know that you can take Jesus to anybody? When you are surrendered and you are that donkey and you're carrying the Son of God into their lives and they need him, you can do that with anybody. I don't care who it is. You can take Jesus to anyone. I told you the story before, but the Lord's telling me to say it again. I've done it a lot. And I worked in this company out west. It was building houses in the shop. We take them out and assemble them. And there's one guy working there named Tim, about 6'7", 6'8", great big guy, busted face. He just got out of Marine prison. Tough, tough, tough guy. Fought constantly. And I was up here in the corner by myself, cutting headers and trimmers for the doors. I was so happy. I was going home to Maine in a few months. And I was all done with college, and I was just feeling my oats, man. I was feeling good. And God said, I want you to go talk to Tim and tell him about my son. Now, Tim's the biggest, meanest guy. These guys, most of them were work release prisoners. They had to go back to prison that night. So I worked with these prisoners. They're going back on the bus. After work, they had to go back to the bus. Man, it was sad. And Tim's the biggest, meanest one of them all. Now, he's free now. He got out of prison. But he was just beat up. Face, broken nose, and he had tattoos of a shish kebab with eyeballs and fingers on it. Just a mean guy. Of all the guys in the shop, that's who God wants this donkey to carry Jesus into his life. The meanest, toughest guy could pick me up and break me in half. But I'm free. I kenosis a couple of years ago. I have koinonia with the Father, so being the donkey, I got to go down the hill. So he said, I want you to go tell Tim about Jesus. And I turned around, so I thought maybe God had somebody else stand behind me. And I said, okay. I kind of said, okay. And it went on the rest of the day, and he said, I want you to, okay, okay. Next morning, I want you to tell Tim about Jesus. I finally said, okay, okay. I really did this out loud. Okay, okay. And I said, you want me to do it? You prepare it. Kind of mean, wasn't it? Telling God that?
Yeah.
Yeah, I did. I said, if you want me to do it, you set it up. Just like that. So smoke break happened. And Tim was usually the first one out in the yard smoking. And he stood there at the table. Everybody left. The whole shop emptied. It was just me and Tim. 40 guys left. It's me and Tim. I'm up there and Tim's back there. And God said, go right now. So I took a bunch of boards down and I stacked in the bin and I said, hey, Tim. He goes, yeah. It didn't help at all. Yeah. God is good.
Amen.
God is so good. I said, Tim. Yeah. So I got a question for you. Yeah, I said, it's from God. From God? That's what he said, from God. Said, yeah. He wants to know when you're going to stop. When are you going to stop running? Got real quiet. It always makes you nervous. And I turned around, and there's this big guy with just tears. Streaming down his face. He goes, how'd you know? Just pointed out. That man's life turned around. 3 months later, he's getting ready to move, and he's moving to Arkansas. He was one of the few guys in the country that could change these certain tires on earth movers. He got a tremendous job. A lot of stories in between that time and when he left. And so I came in one day, I was a crane operator. And I came in, and I said, he goes, hey, preacher, they call me preacher. I said, yeah, because I'm moving, I'm leaving Monday, it's Friday. I said, okay, I said, I'm coming in tonight, you know what I need to do. I'm doing this. He goes, okay, I know what to do. I said, all right, I'm coming in. So at 4 o'clock I came in, I said, you ready? He goes, I'm ready. I went out and got in this car, great big guy, little tiny car. And he's holding the wheel, and he bows his head, and he asks Jesus into his heart. Can we be the donkey today? See, kenosis and the koinonia, it's so sweet. It's a depth of fellowship where we will step into the will of God, free from self, and everybody around us will recognize Jesus Christ, not us. That little donkey disappeared in the crowd that Sunday, or that day. What a way for us to go into Easter Sunday. Being so emptied of self, so kenosis, that we stand broken and spilled out before the Father. And we have this koinonia, a deep, uninterrupted fellowship with God. And we get to bring His Son into other people's lives. Can this happen before Easter? And I have to ask, have you allowed it to happen? I didn't plan any of that stuff with Tim. And I have dozens of stories like that. I had no plans of doing that. I was a donkey that day. I asked Pastor Murray to start some music. I invite you to stand this morning. I'm going to ask it again to we donkeys. Can we have this happen before Easter? I have to ask first, have we allowed the hand of Jesus to set deeply upon our souls and spirits? If it's happening right now, could we resist the urge to spiritually buck that hand off? Have we finally felt the need to surrender to Him? Surrender all of who we think we need to be. And as we do, could we stand ready for such an infant? I ask you to bow your heads and close your eyes this morning. Miss Ann said that our altars are always open if you want to come down and pray. But we can be surrendered right there where we stand if we want to. You just have to pray and ask the Lord to come into your heart. Perhaps you've served the Lord at one time or another, and we've drifted away. Very easy to do. Maybe you just need to come home. Whatever it is, this Sunday before Independence Day, Easter, could we surrender to the hand of the Savior this morning? I don't know, it's not in the books. I never found it anywhere, but the natural proclivity of self is to buck against that hand. And I did for years. 30 plus years in the church, I bucked against it. Could we stop bucking today? And just surrender to God? I can't tell you what's going to happen. All I know is that you're going to find a love you never realized was there. Perhaps we are right with the Lord, and He's been asking us to do a couple things. Perhaps He's calling us to be a donkey today and lead or go into the lives of those around us who meet Jesus and let them see Jesus. The good part about the story is by the time the people get done praising, they probably didn't even think about the donkey anymore. All they could focus on was Jesus. Mm-hmm. And that's how it works. We disappear. So perhaps we need to be the donkey today and carry Jesus into somebody's life. Who is it you know today? Would you pray today, right now, that God would give you the courage to go and speak to them? You know they need Jesus. That little donkey went from being beside its mom to walking into a multitude of thousands of people. It must have been scary. Father, today could you be with us as we would say yes to you? We would be those donkeys. Father, give us what we need to allow the moment of kenosis, broken and spilled out, to take place, and all of us gets dumped out at the foot of the cross. And your Holy Spirit rushes in. It's been waiting all this time. It rushes in and fills us up, and man, we have koinonia, the fellowship like never before. We see Jesus like we never knew Jesus was there. It's brand new. Whatever way you're calling to us today, Father, I pray we'd say yes. In the Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ, I bind any foolishness that would come against this day. Any. Nine times out of ten, it's just us being us. It's just self-rising up. I remember those days so good. But somewhere out there, Lord, there's a Tim for each one of us. He needs to hear Jesus. He just got out of prison. So, Father, be with us as we would carry you into the lives of others this week. And who knows, maybe we'll have a whole bunch of folks here on Sunday to hear the salvation message of Easter. We love you, Lord, and we want to be those donkeys today. We wrote our names above those donkeys, and that's us today. So, Father, be with us. Give us what we need from your Spirit. And we're going to give you all the praise, Lord, for whatever happens when we give you the praise, because it's you doing it. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Look at your neighbor one more time and say, hee-haw!
You're silly. Happy Palm Sunday.